Congressman Jerry Litton believes that a democracy depends on informed people. He also believes our government should be more open and accessible to the people. To better inform the people of what is happening in their government, Congressman Litton of Missouri's 6th District invites Washington personalities to come to Missouri each month and join him in an unrehearsed question and answer open to the public town meeting to discuss key issues facing our nation. Dialogue with Litton brings you closer to our government and Washington closer to you. Standing here in the midst of Congressman Jerry Litton's monthly television program. Congressman Litton brings a political figure back to his 6th District of Missouri once each month, a specially chosen figure. We have a big crowd today. To my right is Mr. Will Adams from Liberty, Missouri. Will's playing the beautiful music. I appreciate it. I know the people are enjoying it. While we're here, I'm going to walk around and talk to a few of the people and just find out where they're from, why they came to Congressman Litton's meeting, and maybe what they do in life. I'll walk over this way. I see a man I think I'd like to talk with. Hi.
Hi.
Do you enjoy these meetings?
Very much. I attend most all of them.
You think it's a good idea for the congressman to keep in touch with the people of his district this way?
I think it's the best way to keep in contact with them, because we can all come and we can ask him questions, and we get the right answer right from the mouth.
That's good. And you enjoy the guests that he brings?
Very much. Especially the pretty one he brought this time.
Let's see. I'll walk around here a little further and see who I can talk to. Oh, here's a handsome man. Hi. Where are you from?
DeKalb County.
DeKalb County?
Yes.
What town?
Pattonsburg.
Pattonsburg, Missouri.
That's right.
I see. And what do you do in life?
I farm.
You farm?
Yes.
Have you been coming to these meetings very often?
Yes, we haven't missed one in a year anyway.
You haven't? No. Oh, are you enjoying the guests he brings?
Oh, certainly.
Do you have any ideas? Do you have any suggestions for a guest Congressman Litton could bring back to his district?
Oh, not offhand. The ones he's named are real interesting to me.
Let's see. If you could point out one thing right now that you think's on the minds of all of these people here today, what do you think it would be? Some questions they might be asking.
I'd say in regard to the economy, in light of what's been in the news this week.
Well, maybe you'll ask an interesting question today and we'll get a good answer.
Maybe.
We're glad to have you here.
Thank you.
See if there's someone else I can talk with. Hi. Have you found that we get a variety of people that come out to these meetings, different ones with the different guests, or is it usually the same people?
Oh, it seems to be a real wide variety, I think. We have a large congregation that comes from DeKalb County each month.
What do you do? Are you a housewife or do you work?
I'm a part-time bank teller.
Part-time bank teller. Well, we're glad you came. We hope you enjoy the meeting. Nice to see all of you here. I think Congressman Litton is ready to start the question and answer session, so I'll turn the program over to him.
In November, on the 5th, the American people elected 435 members of the House of Representatives and one-third of the United States Senate. Of that, 93 new members were elected to the House, and 16 were women. And our guest today is one of the 93 new members and one of the 16 women. She's a mother of four. Her husband is president or dean, I suppose, of the College of Education, Kansas State University. Her brother-in-law was just elected United States Senator from Colorado. I had the opportunity and pleasure to go into Kansas and campaign with her. And it didn't take me very long to decide that she was ready to stage a upset victory, which she did. Neither did it take me very long to realize that she was going to be someone that was going to be heard from in the halls of Congress. She's bright. She's articulate. She's competent. She is Congresswoman Martha Keys from Kansas. Let's welcome her.
especially fortunate to have my really first engagement as a congresswoman-elect be with you, Congressman Litton, a man whom I've respected and come to admire very much.
Thank you. This is going to be an interesting format, Martha. You'll get used to it in Washington, but you'll find these people a little more pleasant. Their questions aren't always that difficult, and they're very kind and courteous to our guests, particularly new congresswomen from Kansas.
Wonderful.
We have two microphones here, and I would like to ask the people who have questions to come to the microphone. Please give your name and your town, if you would, please. Question here.
My question is, does your constituency express a strong desire for a cradle to the grave, single choice, no option, compulsory national health insurance paid for by compulsory taxation?
That's an interesting question.
Yes, that is. You know, we now spend about $100 billion for our total national health bill this year. That is broken up roughly into three different areas. I hope you agree with this, Jerry. Basically, we spend about a third of it out of our own pockets. Basically, we spend about a third of it from national health insurance that we already have, because the government does provide insurance through Medicare and Medicaid. And the rest of it comes through private health insurance. Now, somehow, with all of this patchy scheme of things that we have now, we're just not doing the job that we should be doing of making the fine health technology we have available to all our citizens. You know, some of our statistics in terms of relating to other nations of the world are pretty frightening. We stand something like 15th among nations of the world in infant mortality. We stand 18th in doctor-patient ratio among other nations of the world. And we stand about 26th in terms of life expectancy. So that says to me that though we have very fine health technology, we're just not doing the job that we should be doing of making it available.
One of the problems with health care is that we've heard it discussed for so long as being socialized medicine.
Right.
I don't think anybody likes anything that has a definition or any connotation having to do with socialized anything. But the average American driving down the road, seeing a friend or a neighbor or just another human being alongside the road, injured, in pain, bleeding, hurt, would stop to help. I don't know of anybody in this room that wouldn't stop to help someone who was alongside the road that was in pain or hurting. Basically, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about America as a unit, as a people, as a country, stopping to help. We're doing the same thing as a nation, as we would do individually if called upon. I don't think that we want a situation that really is a cradle-to-the-grave approach, as was indicated in the question. But the cost of health care is so tremendously high now, there has to be some assist so that every American need not go through life fearful that they might have the kind of an illness that would wipe out all of their income, and any income or any hope that their children might have for an education and an opportunity to be useful citizens. So I suspect we'll have something in between the so-called socialized medicine approach that was originally suggested in the Kennedy bill and the compromise version, more commonly referred to as Kennedy Mills. I suspect that will be coming out of Congress, and I'm convinced some kind of legislation will become law in the next session.
What do you think the policy on taxation, what changes do you anticipate in tax policies, tax rates, and so forth, will come out of the next Congress?
Jim, that's a good question, and I think there's a possibility we might have something in the next two or three weeks. Wilbur Mills is very anxious to do something. And I think he's anxious to show us that he has expertise in other areas. I think what we're probably going to come up with is something along the lines of the president's request. There will probably be some reductions in the tax load on low-income people. There'll probably be some changes in investment credit to cause people to invest in their business and pump up the economy. I suspect there'll be some changes in capital gains I'm also of the opinion there'll probably be a minimum tax established for those in the high-income category, which will see to it that people pay taxes no matter how much money they make or how many opportunities might exist for loopholes.
I am concerned that the moves we make to encourage investment in credit by business, by corporations, are moves that will be used to bring productivity and more jobs. I think sometimes we have given preferences in the past in this direction and it hasn't been used in that way. I believe that we do need at this point to give some easement to lower income people in terms of giving a little tax break. I think it would provide a spur to the economy that would be good and it would help make up for some of the tremendous loss in buying power. But basically, I am so totally for the reform, the ones that you mentioned, and I've spoken up consistently during the course of the campaign for what I feel is a necessity, and that is ending the oil depletion allowance and some of the tax preferences that have been given to that particular industry that have outlived its usefulness. So I think there are strong moves that need to be made in the terms of tax reform, and we should be looking much more toward bringing in more revenue through closing off some of the major loopholes than looking to substantive cutting of the budget at this time to try to bring a better fiscal policy at the national level.
I expect that the depletion allowance will be phased out. It seems to be a priority now in the committee. And most particularly, I'm hopeful that some of the incentives that have been used in the past to encourage oil companies to explore oil abroad will be discontinued, because certainly we found that it's not in the best interest of our country to get oil companies in America drilling oil abroad, because at any time they decide that we can't get that oil, it's stopped. And I'd like to see the tax incentives designed to cause them to find oil in this country. I might add that it a lot of people say, well, you're talking about lowering the tax base and load for low-income people, and that's just a political ploy. But it's more than that this time. It really is. If you look at the things that have gone up the most in the last 2 years, you'll find that it hits especially hard at the low-income and most particularly at the elderly. Those things that have gone up the most include food, fuel, gasoline, and hospital care. And if you'll take a look at the expenses of older people, the senior citizens, and the low income, you'll find that this consumes a substantial amount of their total budget. So when you increase those things substantially, there almost has to be a reduction in the tax load to these people to give them a standard of living anywhere near what they were able to enjoy a couple of years ago. And many of the older people have savings accounts, and as opposed to land and holdings, land has gone up in value. The money in the savings account has gone down due to inflation. So I think there's a real sincere interest to try to help those that have been hurt the hardest with inflation, and it's more than just a political ploy.
Congressman Litton, what bill could you possibly introduce into Congress? The article that was in the Times the other day stating that if we help countries giving them food, they have to reciprocate back. And the way I read it and interpreted it was controlled population. The Pope came out with a comment in rebuttal to yours that the United States does not have control over the population of the world. I'm totally in accord what you stated in the paper, if they printed it correctly. But what type of legislation could you possibly introduce into Congress that you could not get ramifications from the churches and from everybody else to being able to help the food problem in the other parts of the world?
I understand the question raised, and when I was in Africa, I traveled one country after another, not only the have-not countries in Africa, but the have countries as well. I went to Nigeria, and this is an African country who last year sold $2.5 billion worth of oil. This year they're selling over $8.5 billion worth of oil. This is a very wealthy country in Africa. I asked them if they had any plans at all to help the starving African nations north of them at this time, and they said they had none. I asked the president of Downey, another country in Africa that is reasonably well off economically, if they had any plans to provide aid or food to the starving African nations to the north. They said they had none. They had roads to build, things to do. So I had the feeling that they weren't really willing to help themselves. We saw the same thing happen in the Arab world with all the oil money they have and the money they're pumping into the United States. They're not helping their own poor neighbors within the Arab world. They're sending them to us. That's the first part of it. I think many of these countries ought to help their neighbors before they turn to us and ask us to help their neighbors. Secondly, we visited many of these countries where the population growth almost exceeds mathematics. You just can't imagine the growth that they have. Bangladesh, for example, that's a country that's about the size of Missouri or Kansas. And yet in 25 years, at the present growth rate, the population of Bangladesh, a country the size of Missouri, will exceed the population of the entire United States of America. Now, they can't feed the people that are there now, let alone the tremendous population that's going to be there in the next 25 years. I asked the leaders of six African nations upon each stop what plans they have in terms of population to hold their population in check. And eyebrows were raised, and members of the American embassy frowned at me so as to say, don't ask that question. And yet they knew every time I came to the embassy I was going to ask that question. And finally, one of the African leaders says, that's a dirty word in Africa. And I said, you mean because of religious implications? No, he says, not because of religious implications. He said, we simply think we ought to be able to produce as many people as we want. That's our business. That's our internal affairs. It's a dirty word over here. And I finally told him, I said, well, it may be a dirty word over here, but back in America, helping those countries that aren't willing to help themselves is getting to be a dirty word there, too. Well, then I went on to Rome, and it was the most interesting experience there because there were 130 nations. 100 of those 130 were standing in line to not the United States. They didn't seem to come there to solve the world hunger. They appeared to come there to downgrade the United States. China was there. Their delegate spoke and made it very clear they didn't intend to help other countries. Russia was there. They gave no hope of helping other countries. The United States was there. We've given $25 billion in food aid in recent years to countries around the world. It wasn't China that was criticized. It wasn't Russia that was criticized. It was the United States that was criticized. If this doesn't tell us that our approach of buying friends around the world is not working, I don't know what does. And I came away there with an entirely different opinion than many of our other delegates did. Many came away from that Rome meeting suggesting that we ought to spend more money and give more food away. And I came back with an entirely different feeling. It hasn't worked. They simply aren't thankful for the help that we've given them. They apparently have not only bad manners, but short memories. And I came back and announced to the press that I intended to introduce a bill. We have it completed. We've got it in the hopper now, which says simply this, that our Public Law 480, the Food for Peace Program, $1 billion a year that goes for food, will not go to any country except in emergency-type situations. Its population growth exceeds the world average unless they have some kind of a family planning program or trying to do something in terms of checking their population. Now, all it says is we're willing to help those who are willing to help themselves. World hunger is caused by too many people and too little food. And you've got to attack it on both fronts. You can't simply attack it on the food end alone because it's very simple. The population is going to outstrip food production. Now, the criticism from some who have said that we're mingling and interfering in the internal affairs of other countries, and my response is this. A, they don't have to have our food aid if they don't want it, and they're not willing to help themselves. They don't have to have us interfering, so to speak, in their internal affairs. They can conduct them as they see fit and get food elsewhere from other countries who don't care whether they do their part or not. And secondly, it appears to me that asking the United States to give tens of millions of dollars of food away at a time when we're short is mingling in our internal affairs, too. That's my point.
Thank you. That's what I wanted to hear.
Jerry, a while ago you said that you were against helping those countries that are not willing to help themselves. And I agree, but what do you think about helping those people in our own country who are not willing to help themselves?
I have the same philosophy. And I might add that I've said and said repeatedly that I don't believe that anybody should get welfare that is not, except those who are too old or disabled and because of health cannot work. I don't believe anyone should get welfare unless they're willing to work or be trained for a job, period.
Well, one more question. How can we find out who is able and who is not able to help themselves? Is there any way to work with that?
Of course, this is a most difficult thing from an administrative standpoint, and oftentimes it becomes more expensive to find those who are getting welfare that don't deserve it than it is to simply pay the welfare to the exceptions and to those people who violate the law. And from an economic standpoint, I suppose that one has to be reasonable and recognize that you can't stop everybody from getting some handout that doesn't deserve it because the cost of stopping it all may be greater than the savings earned. So we have to be reasonable about it. I expressed my philosophy to you, and I've tried to convey that philosophy to the halls of Congress every time that I voted. It's not always easy because sometimes you have legislation that's very complicated, and there may be 60 sections to it. You may like 44 sections, and you may have questions about the other, and then it becomes a matter of do we vote for it because you like most of the bill, even though there's some parts of it you don't like. It's difficult. We have to vote yes or no. We can't vote maybe.
Well, it's nice to know that you're working on it because we really have been concerned. I think the whole country has. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha. You can come in on this. This is going to be a tough one for you, too.
Right. I tend to be a little concerned about an attitude toward welfare recipients that sees them as somehow getting something for nothing, because I think there are many times when the private sector just doesn't offer the jobs to supply to our people, and if we have no kind of public employment or anything like that, then we certainly have long ago accepted the fact that we do have to help people with basic subsistence. I think we should look at it much more in that light, and that our welfare programs should be ones that would be designed to help people move out of dependency into an independent situation where they can hold a job when the job becomes available. I have read some statistics. I have talked to some people who have done some extensive investigation, and actually, at least certainly in Kansas, there is a very, very low percentage of people who are taking undue advantage of the welfare system. Most of the people are either people who are aged, who are incapable of working, who are ill, or something like that. There are really very, very few that are there that could be holding down a job of any kind. But I'm very interested in doing something about revising the system that we have and encouraging people and helping people to get out of the dependency of welfare, because it certainly is nothing to be desired, I think, by anyone.
Skip Tinnen from Plattsburgh, and I would like to know what we could expect, perhaps, from the President's trip to Japan.
Skip, that's a good question. I was very surprised when President Ford, just as he left, announced a change of position of the United States relative to export imports with Canada. I applaud his efforts, and I support what he did, and I suspect that perhaps what he said with regard to Canada may be an indicator as to what he may say of Japan. We have been buying so much more from Japan than they've been buying from us because they have quotas, and they will not permit us to sell our product to their country in many cases, and they continue to dump their products on our country. In Canada, they have been selling their meat to the United States when our price was higher. They have been preventing us from exporting our meat to Canada when their price was higher. President Ford announced that this was going to stop, and I applaud him for saying that, and I think perhaps it was an indicator to the people in Japan what the position that he may take when he gets there. I hope so.
Will out of Liberty, Missouri, two quickies. Which way does each of you lean at the present time on confirmation of Rockefeller as vice president and on the proposed congressional pay raise?
You want to start that?
I don't consider myself even leaning on the Rockefeller nomination because I expect it to be handled before I get there. So I'd like to kind of duck that one. And that tells you something of my expectations. in terms of congressional pay raise, I must say I would be unable to vote for that. I think with the economic problems we have in this country, we've got to see leadership starting in Congress.
Well, I've already voted against congressional pay raise twice, and when I did, I suggested that I hardly figured that during times of inflation, when we're asking people to buy less and drive less and slow down and cut back, that the United States Congress would be setting the proper example by raising their own pay. So I voted against it and would intend to do so in the future. The Rockefeller situation is a difficult one. Our own Judiciary Committee has yet to hear the matter. That's the committee that will recommend to us. And while I know people will suggest perhaps I'm hedging, I think it would be inappropriate for most House members, and I've felt this way during the impeachment consideration, before our own committee that's been set aside to study the matter has even had a chance to study it, let alone recommend to us to indicate in advance how we intend to vote. That's like being a member of a jury and announcing before you go into the trial, into the hearing, that the man is either guilty or not guilty. I think you ought to go in there and hear the facts. Our committee has not heard it, nor have they made recommendations. I would expect Mr. Rockefeller to be confirmed, however. Our time is up. We've had an interesting visit with Martha, and I do want to welcome you to the United States Congress, and I'm sure you'll find it very enjoyable, and I hope you can come back to Missouri often and visit with our people.
I hope so. Thank you.
The program portion of these meetings are always open to the public. If you can't come here and attend them in person, we hope that you can tune in on the more than 20 television and radio stations around the Midwest that carry Dialogue with Litton. We have some interesting guests coming up in the future. Democratic Senators Lloyd Benson from Texas, Mondale from Minnesota, Scoop Jackson from Washington, Republican Senator Lowell Weicker from Connecticut, Ann Armstrong, Counselor to the President of the United States, FDR Jr., the son of the late President, and many, many more. So we hope you join us next month as we continue to bring government to the people.
Thank you. Each month, Missouri Congressman Jerry Litton invites a well-known public figure to come to Missouri and join him in an unrehearsed two-hour question and answer open to the public town meeting. This has been a 30-minute edited portion of this month's meeting. Dialogue with Litton is presented on this station monthly in order to keep you better informed as to what is going on in our government.